I'd like to welcome you to morning worship, especially our guests and visitors. Everyone's asked to sign the red friendship pad, and please do so and share it with those on your row, and after all have signed, you can pass it back. Buried somewhere in here is this yellow card. If you're here for the first time and you fill out a yellow card, give it to someone wearing a red tag, after the service, you get a coffee mug. What a wonderful deal. It has to be filled out completely, though, and don't give us a fake email address. We want your real email address. I'm glad you're here today. Just a few announcements. We're very happy that the Beaton Boss had a baby boy, Bodie. That's in your announcements. Also, please note that next Sunday, we're going to have a sort of a welcome back to school celebration of our teachers and students. So keep that in mind as well. It's a big day because today we're welcoming our new interim director of choirs, Carol Piatnik McCoy, who is also joined by her daughter today, Katie, and we're glad that you're both here today, and it's wonderful to have you, Carol, and Katie as our guest musician today. God bless you both, and may God bless your ministry richly here. Also, please note the needs for Interfaith this month, which are listed in your bulletin. Let us prepare ourselves for worship.
Those who cry to the Lord in times of trouble. God deliver from their distress.
Let them thank the Lord for steadfast love and wonderful works to humankind.
Let us worship God. Be able to stand. Hymn number 41. O worship the King, all glorious above.
Christ, you have established our eternal birthright. By your Spirit, you make us to know your godly decree. As we dwell evermore in the fold of your heavenly heritage, we blend our voices with the multitudes and sing to you songs of praise and many prayers, like the one your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
then you have been raised with Christ, set your mind on things that are above.
For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God.
Put to death, therefore, what is earthly to you, fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry.
For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God.
But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth.
For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God.
Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourself with a new self.
For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God.
The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
It's time for the children's sermon right now. Hold on and sharing the peace. We've got some kids here, and we've got Hannah here. If I can get those kids to come to Hannah, then we've got a children's sermon. Y'all come up. They're coming.
Two things that have nothing to do with each other. We're talking about monkeys and greed.
Okay.
So, do you guys know how to trap a monkey? If a monkey walked in here right now and someone asked you to trap it, how would you do it? That is true, we don't want rabies. So we trap it, and we're not gonna use our hands at all. So I don't particularly like this story because it makes me feel bad for the monkey. But I'm gonna tell you guys how they trap monkeys in other areas of the world. So they take this thing that's called a gourd, which is like a big round squash kind of, and they hollow it out, and what they do is they make a teeny little hole on the outside of it, and they fill it with rice. And so when they fill it with rice, they leave it. The monkey comes and puts his paw in and grabs the rice. Now I want you to make a fist. Can you go like this and make a fist? Can you see how your hand kind of gets bigger and it gets really tight? So when he tries to pull his hand back out, it's stuck. So now he's got a squash on his hand, and somebody in the last service asked me a really good question. Well, why wouldn't the monkey just run away? I don't know. They're not as smart as you guys are. So he's stuck there. And then he just sits there and waits until the trappers come get him. So he was so greedy with that rice, all he wanted was that rice, and he didn't want to give it up, and so his hand got stuck, and then he sat there until they came and got him. So that's why monkeys have to do, that's how monkeys have to do with greed. And so our story today, a man came to Jesus and said, "Please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." He replied, "Friend, who made me a judge to decide such things as that?" Then he said, "Beware against every kind of greed. Life isn't measured by how much you own." Then he told them a story. A rich man had some rich land that produced fine crops. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have enough room in my barn to hold all my crops." Then he said to himself, "I know. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I will have enough room for all my crops. And I will sit back and say to myself, take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry." But God said to him, "You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for?" This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but does not have the riches of God. So have you guys heard when people say that when you die, you can't take things with you? So that's what they're talking about. It's all those things that we think are so important to us today. When we die, we can't take them with us. So God's telling us not to be greedy with those things. So will you guys pray with me? Let's bow our heads, and if you guys will repeat after me. Dear Father, help us to be content with the blessings which you so generously give us, and help us to be on guard against selfishness and greed. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Share the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. And share this with one another.
Well, and good morning. We're all here to greet you. And good morning. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
forgot to mention that. Thank you, Rusty. You may be seated. Please pray with me. O God, on our rock and redeemer and solace for all who call on your name, we behold the vision of your holy splendor and bow down before you in humble submission. You are God. There is no other. All else fades and withers, while you endure throughout the ages. With angels, archangels, prophets, apostles, and martyrs who have gone before, we join in giving you praise and thanksgiving. Your grace abounds. We receive of its abundance. You exceed our expectations and needs. There is never a day that we cannot list the gifts of your love. From morning until nightfall, we are upheld by your care. Having been raised by Christ, we will set our minds on your heavenly splendor. We will trust your Holy Spirit to guide us when earthly desires distract us. We pray that you will be with those who are not feeling well today. Some are here, and some are home. And some cannot come here anymore, but their hearts are here, O God, and with you. Bless them, let your healing spirit abide with them. Be with those who have lost someone they love recently or long ago, and take them on the grief's journey, O God, and never forsake them, but be steadfast as you have been through all the ages. Your sons and daughters ask you to claim us, so as we go forth to all people, we will witness your love, as we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Let us bring our gifts to Almighty God. You have taught us how to trust your goodness and lay up treasure in heaven. We offer you gifts in response to your word. We bring you a portion of what our labor has gained in thankful praise for the abundance we have. We give you our souls in humble obedience, for in Christ we inherit eternal life. Be pleased with our offerings, Holy One. They are signs of your mercy. Amen. Please be seated.
I will be reading the first scripture lesson of today. It's in your Bible, Hosea 11, 1 through 11, on page 1032. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in the arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with the cords of human kindness, the bands of love. I was to them like those who, like infants, lifted infants to their cheeks and bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt, and Ezra shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oral priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Edom? How can I treat you like Zebeon? My heart recoils with me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy him. For I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. They shall go after the Lord, who roars like a lion. When he roars, his children shall come trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like birds from Egypt, and like doves from the land of Assyria. And I will return them to their homes, says the Lord. The end of the first lesson.
Thank you, Rusty. Our gospel lesson is from Luke, as it has been for some weeks now, contained in the lectionary, chapter 12, verses 13 through 21. Hear the word of God. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But Jesus said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do, for I have no place to store my crops?" Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night, your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This is always a difficult passage to preach about because it sounds a lot like finger pointing. Because couldn't we just all agree that greed is bad and move on and not have to hear more about it? But Jesus had something to say about it, and we want to get into that just a little bit about how he said beware of all kinds of greed. There's also something else that's interesting in this passage. Perhaps you have thought something that was in the Bible and it wasn't, but you always thought it was there. Or something was in the Bible you didn't know was there. Eat, drink, and be merry. Sounds like Shakespeare, but it's in the Bible. In fact, if you want to go on to Google that this afternoon, if you're bored, there is plenty of sites to say, is it Shakespeare or Google? Or the Bible. It's on Google. Stephen Hawking said, when he was living, pollution, greed, and stupidity were the greatest threats to the earth. And he said, we certainly have not become less greedy or less stupid. These are things that worried this man, who is not a believer, but a brilliant man anyway. What we do with things is what this is about. I found this quote from an Indian philosopher, Brahmakumar Nikunji, and if you know him, you should read more of his stuff, because it's very good. He said, greed is a kind of hunger that is never satisfied. Our desire for food ends when our hunger is appeased. Our anger also subsides when its purpose is achieved. But greed creates a tendency in which the mind is not satisfied, even if we get the kingdom of the whole world. And he goes on, says, the funniest thing about wealth is that the one who possesses it is always under threat of losing it. The one who does not possess it is always yearning for it, and the one who possesses it in balance is always sad while parting with it. And I don't know how balanced I am, but I found myself in that third spot some years ago through circumstances beyond my control, no fault of my own. I had to go out and buy a used car, which I did. And you could say I didn't buy it well. It was only a couple of years old. It seemed like a decent deal, and I got it. It wasn't 3 years old, and I had it for about 2 months, and the air conditioner quit. I mean, it just died. It didn't just say, well, it needs a little work or a charge or Freon or blah, blah, blah. No, $1,224. And the fact that I can still remember that figure is a little shocking. That's how sad I was about parting with the money. I looked up on the internet, which is helpful sometimes. I looked on the internet, and that was a little high for the repair for this particular vehicle, which I will not name, because you may be driving. Good luck if you are. And but the people who would charge me less wanted me to wait 3 weeks, in the middle of a summer in Florida. No deal. I fixed it, and then I sold that car for spite. But it made me sad. It really did. To part with the money, what does it matter? You know, if something breaks, you fix it. This is capitalism. And as an American, I believe that capitalism is the best economic system in a free society. I believe that capitalism is a system that allows the greatest opportunity for the most people. No one can say, though, that capitalism is fair. For nothing in this world really is. We understand the need for regulations and looking out for people who work and the environment and companies who might exploit said people and things were they not given the chance. And though we may be limited somewhat in our understanding of capitalism, the object of capitalism, I think I understand that, is to make money for the capitalist. That, of course, is the bottom line. And our church father, John Calvin, would have been just fine with that. He believed that work and making money was a good thing for faith to move forward. But if making money is inherently good and greed is bad, we have a few serious questions to ask in relation to our faith. How much is enough and how much is too much? When do we say enough already? It's a capitalist question. I mean, if we were socialists or communists, someone would tell you what was enough. There, you have your potato. Go. That's not how it works. So maybe the words of Christ feel a little uncomfortably hitting home for us today. And he says something else interesting, doesn't he? Beware of all kinds of greed. And I just thought there was just the one kind, but Jesus says beware of all kinds of greed. I looked up greed because I had to at this point, and came up with this definition, which has got two big words we never use but are easy to understand. Reprehensible acquisitiveness. Bad wanting to get stuff. But the reprehensible acquisitiveness sounds a lot more, I don't know, frou-frou. But the point is, the definition of greed never says money at all. We can be greedy by keeping many things to ourselves and acquiring more and more, and we can be greedy with anything, even recipes. There was a lady in my church, not this church, but several churches ago. And we had a potluck it was a monthly potluck, and every month she brought something different. And every time it was wonderful. And without doubt, she said, every time someone would ask her for the recipe, and she said, I always give it to them, but I always leave out one or two key ingredients. I'm telling the truth, she said this. Wait, it gets worse. Because they complained, and she told me this, they always complained, it didn't turn out right when I did it. And then she smiled. I mean, it was like an evil smile. It was not the good smile. She smiled because of greed. We can be greedy with things other than money. We can be greedy with our friends, afraid of sharing them with other people because they won't spend enough time with us. We can be greedy with our families, keeping them from having healthy relationships by containing them in the nuclear family. We can be greedy with time itself. And perhaps that is one of the largest greeds of all. And of course, we can be greedy with our possessions for fear of someone breaking them or stealing them. Now, you could argue, you might be right, that greed is perhaps a survival instinct, something primitive in the human brain that makes for survival. This is my stuff. Get your own stuff. Right? I didn't mean to do that. That was interesting. But greed never gives us any satisfaction. The rich man in the parable shows us that greed does not make us satisfied. He has too much and no place to keep it. Not the first person in history to have this problem. And it's certainly a problem today, or there wouldn't be storage units going up all over town. I get excited when I see new construction. I go, it's a storage unit. You ever do that? Because they come up, we still need more places to put our stuff. It's not a new problem, it's an old problem. But I like what else the man says when he talks to his own soul. You know, you ever do that, talking about yourself in third person, or you know, say, Ron, now Ron, what are you doing? But he goes, he does this, he says, I will say to my soul, soul, you've had ample goods laid up for many years. Eat, drink, be merry, relax. Relax. He's not satisfied. But he thinks if the barns are big enough, he can be. How many times have we said the same thing? If only we had a room for that, or a bigger place for this, or if this were larger. Then we can say to our souls, it's big enough. Be satisfied. I don't know if it will ever be that way. John Piper said this about sin and greed too. He says, greed gets its power by persuading me to believe that I will be more happy if I follow it. The power of all temptation is the prospect that it will make me happier. Satisfaction cannot come from what we have, but who we have in Christ Jesus. Greed will get us a better afterlife. Even Hannah said it, you can't take it with you. This barn building fool at the point of total relaxation finds out that God is calling him that very night, and all that work he did, what will it mean? Who will get it? All of that stuff. We can't take it with us. There's no satisfaction. We can't take it, but greed is not going to make us safe. Often we use safety as an explanation for plain old greed. I need to have more so I can be sure that I have enough for a rainy day. And we should plan for our future. That's a good thing. I'm not against financial planning. Believe me, I think it's a great thing. That is not the message here. But after we've done our planning, we have to live with what we have. Listen to it again. What the man wants is safety, peace of mind, a way to have the burden of his survival lifted. But he doesn't get that, does he? We're never going to feel fulfilled by what is around us or what we have, but what is within. Come to the table that way. It doesn't matter if you have a lot of money or no money. Christ is at the table and doesn't ask us how much stuff we have. Christ says, I had everything and I gave it all away for you, that you might have life in abundance. That is the table. Prepare. The feast is ready. Amen. Let us remain seated and sing our communion hymn. You don't know it, but it's a lovely thing. So try and sing it in remembrance of me. Beautiful hymn.
Hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled.
as Jesus gave thanks on the night, that special night when he served this meal, we come now unto God with our prayer of thanksgiving, just as he gave thanks. Let us pray. All glory and thanksgiving be to you, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that you of your great mercy did send your Son, Jesus, to take our nature upon him and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made a full and perfect sacrifice at that time. We thank you for his birth, his life, his precious death, his resurrection, and glorious ascension. And we thank you, Lord, that our Christ is alive here at this table. We ask you to take these gifts that you have given, the bread and the cup, set them apart from all common use to this holy use of mystery. And let us break this bread, that the bread would break and be the body of Christ, and the cup we share his blood. Now also we present ourselves as living sacrifices this day, Holy One, Father, Son, and Spirit, world without end. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Savior took bread. And when he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, our Savior took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. All of you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The gifts of God for the people of God. the body of Christ broken for you. Blood of Christ shed for you. Let's pray. Eternal God, we thank you that you have fed us at your table with the spiritual food and assured us of your goodness towards us, that we are members of the mystical body of your Son and heirs of your everlasting kingdom. Assist us with your grace now as we go henceforth to your glory. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, please stand as you're able. Let us affirm our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our closing hymn is a beautiful one. God's giving knows no ending. 7:16. God the Son and God the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.